Dubai or you know, Jordan or Saudi Arabia, is you have the Sharia law, which basically doesn't allow trusts or wills at all. And you have forced heirship rules where it's divided up into shares, right? The first wife gets this much, the second wife this much, boys get double than girls. And you know, so you can write down in your will whatever you want, they're gonna ignore it. So you really have to use some creative tax planning that a lot of people don't think about when they go to these countries on expat tax assignments. You know, they go, or sorry, expat work assignments. They go there, they wind up buying a house, a car, a few things, and they think, oh, we're gonna leave. And then something happens to one of the spouses, and now all of a sudden, you know, the first son's getting more than the wife. and there's nothing you can do about it. So that all needs to be planned for as well. And then another question is, I mean, and even not talking about like trusts, for example, which I was saying, like trusts aren't recognized at all in Sharia law countries. Some European countries won't let you form them, but they'll recognize their existence. Some tax them quite harshly, some tax them like they don't exist. But this is how complex this can all get. Let's just talk about wills for a second. So what constitutes a valid will? So if you write a will in the United States, will Germany recognize it? Will the Netherlands recognize it? Will the UK recognize it? Maybe, maybe not. Some countries recognize handwritten wills that aren't notarized. Other countries require to be notarized. Some countries require wills to be registered somewhere. Other countries don't. So you run into all these problems, and even if all you want to do is write a will, what laws do you write it under? How is each country going to recognize it? And what happens if you move? You know? So your estate plan really becomes sort of a living, breathing thing that has to be constantly reviewed, updated, changed. And then another issue, and this is something that we see quite a bit, is a lot of people like to leave some amount of money to charity when they pass away. Well, guess what? If you're a U.S. citizen and you leave some of your estate to a U.S. charity, that's great. But what happens if you're living in Germany and you leave some of your money to a German charity? Well, nothing. That doesn't get deducted from your estate. You don't get the advantage of that because it's not a U.S. charity. And the same goes, what happens if a German leaves something to a U.S. charity? It also doesn't count because it's not a German charity. So even if your estate plan had picked out charities that, you know, were compliant for your particular situation, again, what happens when you move? You have to go back and revamp it. There are gift and estate tax treaties, like I mentioned, between several countries. I mean, most European countries have a treaty with the United States. And so they'll give you credit for the taxes paid in the other country. So for example, like if you're a resident of Germany, but you were taxed in the United States due to your citizenship, Germany would give you credit against the German taxes, would give the heirs of the estate credit for the estate taxes paid in the United States, which would help reduce the burden. But not all countries have these estate and gift tax treaties. And some countries have a gift tax treaty, but not an estate tax treaty. Other countries have an estate tax treaty, but not a gift tax treaty. So it can be quite complex. Any questions?
Are you a non-American green card holder in the mix? How does that fit in?
So non-American green card holders really get the worst the worst of America, let's say, because they get all the disadvantages of having to pay income taxes and having to do all the, you know, the foreign reporting, but they get none of the advantages of the gift or estate tax exclusion unless they're domiciled in the US. And that's, and domicile, like I was talking about before, domicile is like your idea of home, the place where you intend to go back to live out your days. So unless a green card holder can show that the U.S. is their domicile, if they can show that the U.S. is their domicile, then they get this estate tax exclusion of $11.2 million for gift and estate taxes. But if they can't, like let's say the domicile is really Germany, and they just have the green card because they're married to an American, then the U.S. is going to say, well, Germany's the domicile, and they're not going to give them these exclusions. And the other trick is that's really disadvantageous about the non-American, the green card holder spouse is if it's the American citizen spouse that dies, leaves something to the green card holder spouse, there's no estate tax exclusion. There's no marital deduction between spouses. You start using the estate tax exclusion basically immediately.
And if she has an estate in Norway,
okay.
And she's in the States 50 years.
Okay.
We're having the problem with also tax in Norway because it's her residence.
Okay.
But it's her second residence for Norway. Mm-hmm. And that's where I'm
at. So I don't have a lot of experience with Norway, so I'm not sure off the top of my head if there is an estate or gift tax treaty with the United States. I would need to look, but generally speaking, sort of both countries' laws would apply to the estate, but if there's a gift and estate tax treaty, then you have these offsetting credits that basically you wind up paying no more than you would in the most expensive country. So, is the way it works. So if you had like, for example, let's say Germany is 50% estate tax, the US is 40, you'd wind up paying your 40 in the US, and you pay the difference of 10 in Germany. It's a very simple example, but you always pay in the highest, exactly.
So going back to what you said, dual citizenship
yes.
is treated as an American citizen.
Yes.
Is that true if you're also living in the country of the dual citizenship
yes.
and not in the U.S.
Yes.
And if you're living in a third country that is neither's country of citizenship,
as long as you, as long, if, as
always
long,
U.S. citizen.
As long, yes, as long if, as a U.S. citizen, you're always treated as a U.S. citizen, and you're always treated as U.S. domicile.
Okay.
As long as you have a U.S. passport. So no matter where you go as a U.S. citizen, the U.S. estate and gift taxes are always going to apply.
What about the wills?
The wills are tricky because it's really every single country where you go has different rules, right? I mean, and some, for example, some countries, even if you write a will, like in certain countries, kids and wives or spouses in general have rights to a certain amount of somebody's estate, regardless of the will. So for example, you could write like a U.S. will, like totally cutting out a spouse or totally cutting out a child, and that being your intent, but the country where you're resident says it doesn't matter what the will says, they have a right to this much of the estate. And so you really have to look at those issues. And then obviously, you know, I mean, which adds a complete other layer of complexity, is if you have U.S. citizen spouses of the same sex that are somewhere, like how's that treated? Because some countries recognize legal rights, you know, in gay marriage, some countries don't. So it can get pretty complex. Yes?
Estate planning itself is very complex.
Yeah.
Situations like as you explained, you're in a totally different country and there is a debt.
Yep.
Is there a time period where governments will allow you to?
No, that's what's called estate planning. You have to do it ahead of time.
That's fair to say that, yeah, that's what I thought you would say,
yeah.
But I was hoping you would also say that there's an opportunity, because these are not...
It's once there's a death, it's too late, unfortunately. I was hoping I could give you the answer you were looking for, but, you know, I mean, most people after hearing this, the only thing they want to plan for is shots. But... once there's a death, it's kind of game over. You're stuck with whatever there was. Oh wait, hold on. There's a question here first.
let's say I have my own house,
uh-huh.
and I decide to give the whole thing to my son, and his name's put on there,
uh-huh.
and it's his house,
yep.
but I get to stay there until I drop dead.
Yep.
Is that a good solution?
Yeah, that can be a solution, and that's actually a solution that works. It's called a life estate, where basically you have the right to stay in the house.
Mm-hmm.
In certain European countries, that works in the U.S., mm-hmm. and in certain European countries, Germany being one of them, that's a very popular solution because it reduces the value
mm-hmm.
of the gift because they can't do anything with the house until you pass away.
Mm-hmm.
So that is a very useful estate planning, very useful estate planning strategy for primary residences, absolutely.
What if it's an apartment that's rented out to somebody and I put my daughter in America, her name on that apartment?
Well, because if it's rented out,
so
that would just be treated as a flat out gift.
Yes, okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not you living,
mm-hmm.
you living in it reduces the value because
yeah.
they can't get any rents or anything
yeah.
for it, but if it's an apartment that's rented out, you don't have that.
Okay.
What
so,
if she gets the rent?
Yeah, that could reduce the value. I mean, you have to look at which countries that works in, though. But yeah, you could do that. You could give something away, but retain an income interest in it, is what it's called. Yeah, those are all things possible. You can give gifts that are subject to certain restrictions. For example, like you can even give a gift where they can get the income, for example, but they can't sell it until you pass away. You can do different restrictions. But what which restrictions are allowed depends on the country you're resident of. In the U.S. is pretty flexible. You can put all kinds of restrictions. Some countries don't allow that as much. I had a question over here.
I don't know if this falls under this. When my kids were born, my husband started putting like an insurance for them that when they reach 25,
mm-hmm.
this insurance they can cash out.
Yeah.
Is that a good idea?
Yes. So.
And he is.
Okay, so that's actually something that's pretty common, and it's a little bit, depending on the value of these insurance policies, it can be nightmarish. So first of all, were the policies all paid at once, or is this something that he pays annually? Okay, so as we were saying earlier, U.S. citizens can receive an unlimited amount from non-U.S. citizens, right? If it's over $100,000 in a year, then it has to be reported. So as long as what he's paying for these insurance policies, so it is a gift to the kids, but as long as the premiums that he's paying are less than $100,000 a year, there's no reporting and no tax or anything that needs to be done on that. What's a little bit nightmarish about these policies is that they are treated as foreign financial accounts for purposes of the FBAR, because they're gonna have a cash value at some point. So they do need to be reported on the FBAR by the kids because they have a financial interest in it. Okay, so it's basically their money at the end of the day. So they would need to be included on an FBAR. Also, depending on the insurance company and the country, the income earned within the insurance policy, just the income portion, could be subject to U.S. tax. There's tax compliant insurance policies and tax non-compliant ones. And it boils down to if the kids have any sort of investment control, like if they could say, we'd like to see the assets in this insurance policy invested like this, then generally the income would be taxed to them. If they have no control over it, which is usually the case, that it's just like a bank or an insurance company that they handle it, you have nothing to say about it, then generally there wouldn't be any tax on the income, but when they go to cash it in, there'll be tax.
Mm-hmm. So there's a double tax deducted. The tax that is paid on the income that is put the safe insurance in.
Yes.
The tax that goes up.
Yeah. Well, I think
different people, but still.
Yes. Tax. Yes. There's double tax. I mean, in essence, you know, I mean, this is all. Gift and estate taxes is basically a double tax, right? If you're paying a gift tax, you have to earn the money that you're gifting away, or you have to earn the money that you're going to leave to somebody in your estate.
What if you are a U.S. citizen
mm-hmm.
that doesn't have assets in the United States?
Okay.
Where you want to count that to pay the taxes?
Yeah.
In the history. And has their brothers and sisters.
Uh-huh.
Who, some of them are American and some are non-American.
Okay.
So according to Colombian law, the person's family is the one who inherits my state.
Uh-huh.
So what's happening with the US law? Does it accept that because I have my address and live away from the United States, do I lose my
But you're a citizen, correct?
Yes, I'm a citizen.
No, that you do not lose it as a citizen. If you were a green card holder and you were living, let's say, in Colombia, and that's where you plan to live out your days, then you would lose it because you're not a citizen and your domicile is not in the U.S. But because you're a citizen, you don't lose the estate tax exclusion.
So only if she owns more than $11 million in assets would she have to worry about the state gift tax in the United States?
That's correct.
Is that what it boils down to?
Yes. Yeah.
So I have to pay estate tax if I
have more than $11.2 million.
She's like, that's it? That's all I get, $11.2 million? What are you doing in Colombia exactly?
For sure, I get that amount of money, but should I form a trust because the others are citizens, but they don't are compliant citizens?
They're non-compliant citizens? Really? What? I would definitely, I would actually very much consider forming a trust, and I would put in potentially as a condition in the trust that only tax compliant citizens can inherit. Maybe that would be something that would motivate them to get tax compliant. I mean, the thing is, if you leave the assets to a non-compliant person, it's not a problem for you. I mean, your problems will be over. but it will definitely be a problem for them. If they receive these assets and they're not tax compliant, it could be an issue when they receive them for them. But that's their prerogative, so to speak. Yeah.
So my husband and I live in Saudi Arabia.
Okay.
And the bank account is in his name.
Yeah.
And the car is in his name.
Yeah.
That's all. Those are the only assets we have there. So what would happen if he died?
So the car and the bank account would be subject to Sharia law, which basically is like a share. It's a weird share system. There's a giant chart for it, and basically it's like the you would obviously be the first wife. you're entitled to a certain percentage no matter what.
Okay.
And then the rest gets split up.
So we have two daughters.
Okay, so that's not good. because if there was a son in the mix, then You and the kids, I believe, get everything.
Okay.
But if there's only daughters and no sons, and it's like you get a percentage, each one of them get a percentage, and then half goes to like the nearest male relative or something. So like a brother or a father or whoever's. It's a weird system.
Okay.
My advice would be, I would just try to keep like the bulk of what's in the bank account, not in Saudi Arabia.
Yeah.
That's our
plan. Yeah.
So,
as soon as he gets paid, we transfer money.
Okay, so it's because one of the nice things about Sharia law is it's territorial. It's not extraterritorial.
Okay.
So like, for example, the U.S.'s law is extraterritorial. It follows you everywhere. But the Sharia law, which is what Saudi Arabia is, it's territorial, so it only applies to assets within Saudi Arabia.
Okay.
So it basically just be the bank account and the car. So, the car is not worth a whole bunch,
I mean, in the scheme of things.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of, at risk, but whatever.
Okay.
I mean, maybe what you might want to do, if possible, is do, like, have it signed over in advance, like, prior to death.
Okay.
With the bank account, I mean, I just keep enough for living expenses in there and
right.
transfer it out to another country, and then that's not such a big deal. Yeah.
Back to expatriating. So, if I understand, you know, the three things, they're four. So, anyone who's worth more than $2 million cannot expatriate and be uncovered.
The only way to do it, and like I was saying in the workshop earlier, if the person was born a dual citizen and still lives in the country of which they're a dual citizen and is taxed as a resident there, then there is a possibility to expatriate even if the net worth is more than $2 million.